I will, and visible to myself also. Okay, as I promised on the Facebook today that in this demo session, we'll be taking a very short and a crisp discussion on a topic, that's aphasia. And as I see, many of the old students have still come in. Thanks a lot for coming in. And we'll try to revise it, what you have read, and I'll tell you something which you don't know. Okay. Let's start with aphasia. If you know aphasic disorder, aphasia is something that you understand. A person cannot understand, cannot speak is a aphasic patient, right? And it's a very common component of any patient whom you see with a stroke episode. Okay. Now, to understand aphasia, I'll spend at least 2 pages of yours in the register or the notebook that you are carrying with you. So let us first try to make a speech circuit and try to understand various kinds of parameters in which we are going to see a patient with aphasia. Okay. Let's start with a very simple speech circuit first. There's an input that we get through the auditory area. Okay. I'll explain it again to you. Don't worry. And there is an input that we get into a visual area or the visual cortex. And all this together is going to combine and reach a particular zone in the brain that is the Wernicke's area. Okay. And from the Wernicke's area, we find the signal will go into the Broca's area. And from the Broca's area, we find that the speech output is going to come out. So if you know the basics, it's very easy. Wernicke's area. What is the main function of Wernicke's? It is possibly helping me to understand something. The work of understanding is known as the word comprehension. Okay. So remember this. The Wernicke's area, the main function is to make me understand or comprehension. Okay. And if you remember anatomically, this Wernicke's area is located where? It's located in the brain in the temporal lobe. So if you remember the area where it is located in, yes. Can someone of you type the first 3 words, an abbreviated term for it? The superior temporal gyrus. Okay. I can use the abbreviated term for that as STG, superior temporal gyrus. Okay. Now something basic anatomy physiology is required at your end for this. Yes. Now, if you remember this superior temporal gyrus, the Wernicke's area that we find has to get a number in the brain. Okay. And what area number is it? Can someone of you tell me that Wernicke's area, the area for comprehension located in the superior temporal gyrus, is having which number area? What is the number that we write for the Wernicke's area? The area for comprehension located in the brain in the superior temporal gyrus. Any answers from your end? I'm waiting, waiting, waiting. This has to be some lag of 30 seconds between me and your communication on this end. I still wait for you. Can you tell me the area number for the Wernicke's area in the brain, the superior temporal gyrus? It's area number 22. 22. Okay, Dr. Ghosh, right? 22. Make it very, very clear. It's another controversy that might pop up somewhere in anatomy. Because they mentioned 39 and 40 also over here. But I've clarified every time in the classroom that it's area number 22. Now, what's the Broca's area doing for me? The Broca's area is doing a very simple work. It is forming the words for me, word formation. The word formation work has to be done in the Broca's area. And where is my Broca's area located? It's been located in the brain again, in the frontal lobe, inferior frontal gyrus or gyri. And don't forget the number again. Yes. The area number where we find the Broca's area being located is what? 44 and 45. Okay. And you all know there is something connecting the one case with the Broca's area. Yes, that's the connection known as a light above. Put an arrow over here. Is the arcuate fasciculus or the arcuate fibers. Okay, I'll draw a diagram also related to it so that you understand everything. Okay, just keep on writing if you're attending the class for the very first time. Don't panic, don't worry, things are going to get clear with time. Now remember this, arcuate fascicle connects the Wernicke's with the Broca's area, right? Now if you know from the background and not me again, where is the auditory area in the brain located? Which lobe of the brain do you talk about? Yes, the auditory area is located in the temporal lobe, okay? Where is the visual cortex located? That's been located in the occipital lobe. Okay, so temporal lobe is a house for the auditory area. Occipital lobe is a house to the visual cortex. We get an input through the auditory or the visual route. Okay, we always get an input, either it is auditory or visual, coming into the Wernicke's area, flowing the signal to the arcuate fasciculus to the Broca's area and speech. Right, and this is all you already know. Now, if you are an old student of ours, now I'll tell you something which you don't know. Okay, student, do ask me sang mala jo mala mait nahi. Tell me something which I don't know. Now, something which I've touched upon in your DVT sessions also, that these Wernicke's area are connected in both the direction. Okay, in both the directions. With another area. Okay, I'll make it like this. So this Broca's and Wernicke's, both of them are connected to another area individually also. Yes, Wernicke's area is associated with the sensory association area, right? The Broca's area is connected to the motor association area, right? So remember this, the sensory association area is connected with the Wernicke's area, the motor association area is connected with the Broca's area. And what's the function of these association areas? You should know about this. Okay, to understand this, we'll take simple examples. What are the things? I'm going to make it again in a simplified way, don't worry. In a diagram also, I'm going to make it, right? Now, remember this, what are the parameters on which you assess a patient with a speech or a language disorder? The first parameter in which you want to assess a patient with a speech and the language disorder, can the patient understand me or not, known as the word comprehension. Now, if you understand the word comprehension, what does it mean? That you understand what I'm telling you, what I'm teaching you is simple, nothing but comprehension, right? Now, for comprehension, how can you know about it? Like, for example, you can ask the patient something like, you know, where is the illumination in the room? He's going to look around, find a bulb or a tube light somewhere and tell you that's there. So maybe the person might speak it out, but most important, if the person has understood my command, he's going to follow it. So in the other spectrum, if you look at this, what is the meaning of the word comprehension? To understand. A verbal input. So whatever verbal input or a command I've given to the patient, if the person understands that, that is known as comprehension. So if you understand this, Wernicke's area is supposed to help me to understand something or comprehension, right? So remember this, comprehension happens through the Wernicke's area in the brain, correct? Right. So have this clarity in your mind. I'll give you other more examples than this so that we understand this topic in a very simplified manner, okay? Second parameter in which you want to make a person is to speak. Speak, fluency, Look at this now. Fluency of the speech. If I'm speaking fluently, what I'm doing? I'm speaking by forming words in my brain. So basically, what is the fluency doing for me? It is assessing one more thing, that is the word formation. So if your speech is fluent, that means you're forming the words correctly, well connected to each other. If the speech is non-fluent, that means the words are not either not formed or they are not connected with each other. So remember this, fluency is something which is judging another area in the brain, that is the Broca's area. Okay. So fluency of the speech assesses the Broca's area. Comprehension more or less assesses the Wernicke's area, right? Ability to understand and ability to speak, right? Number three is naming. Okay. For example, I'll show an object like this. Okay. Yeah. You see this from a distance and you tell me, so it's a mobile phone, right? But I categorically ask you, which company is it? Is it an iPhone or is it a OnePlus? You'll always see it from a distance and tell me, no, sir, it's not an iPhone, because iPhone has got a dot below. That's very pathognomic for an iPhone. So you see an object, you understand that object, and you associate that thing that you've seen in the past, the iPhone, and you say, no, it's not an iPhone, and make an appropriate word related to it. Okay. So catch this point. What is the naming requiring? A visual input and understanding in the Wernicke's area, something to associate with and derive, like, yeah, I've seen this previously also. Yeah, it's a mobile phone, but it's not an iPhone. So what is the main function of the association area? The main function is to help me here to name an object and to derive something that I've seen it previously also, and to make the right word for that object. Okay. I'll show you another example. Yo, sorry for this. If you can see this, who is this gentleman? Oh, some people know him. Good. But an intelligent student will never pronounce his name in the chat box. He'll say, sir, he's a doctor, he's a teacher, he's a cop, he's a firefighter, astronaut, army. So remember this great gentleman. Sorry for this. And is this gentleman, if you've seen him earlier somewhere, you might have seen him in a different kind of a profession. Okay. So depending on the last profession that you have seen him, you would recollect what he is doing in life. Okay. So naming, you have seen this gentleman, you understood who is he, but there is an association area somewhere working for you to tell me not the right name, because you'll be caught. Maybe you are able to tell me the profession of him just to justify yourself, you know him. Okay. So look at this. What is the naming requiring? First of all, the naming requires a visual input, correct? After this, the naming is something, okay, that is requiring another area, that's the Wernicke's area. Okay, but the most important thing, that the signal from the Wernicke's has to go into a sensory association area, correct? And from the sensory association area, the signal has to go back to the Wernicke's. So it's a bidirectional kind of an arrow that I'm trying to draw here. Okay. From there, the signal has to go through the arcuate fascicle, right? And then goes to the Broca's area. But your Broca's area is very smart. You did not tell me the right name is Johnny Sin. You tell me something else, that he is working as a plumber or something, electrician, something. Okay. Signal goes on to a motor association area. Okay. Where the word has been developed, what he is actually. Okay. And then the speech output really comes out. So remember this, that naming doesn't only require Wernicke's and Broca's. It requires an association area also to help me to know who is that person, if I have seen him earlier, or maybe an object which I know I've seen it earlier. Okay. Right. We'll use all these concepts to build up to find which disorder is the patient suffering with. Right. Number four, repetition. So I tell my patient to repeat a sentence like this: I am a donkey. But I insist that you have to say me that I am a donkey. What would happen? This person will listen to me. Okay, you listen to me for repetition. You require which area? Auditory area. Correct. You understand me where? In the Wernicke's area. In the Wernicke's area. Correct. Now, what would happen is that the signal will go to the association area. No. Remember this, for repetition, like I tell you, you are a donkey, you have to repeat it. Or I am a donkey, you have to repeat it. I insist on that. Do you require an association area for that? No, not at all. So I'm telling you to repeat. I'm insisting on you to repeat the same thing. So remember this, for repetition, we do not require association areas. Okay. And then the speech output comes out. So look at this. Repetition requires an auditory input, Wernicke's, in between the arcuate fascicle and the Broca's area and the speech output. So remember this, these are the four parameters on which we assess any patient with a speech or a language disorder. Okay. But remember, sometimes, even for a comprehension kind of a thing, you may require a sensory association area. For example, I tell you to comb your hair. That's a command that I give you. In that case, what will happen? You will pick up your comb, start doing it. Okay? But how you do it is something that you already know from your background experience. So something that association areas will again help me out. So remember this, I'll make it again. For a comprehension thing, I require an input that is auditory, correct? From the auditory area, the signal will go into the Wernicke's area. Okay. From here, the signal will also go into some extent to the sensory association area. Okay. From the past experience, I'll do it. So remember this, always, always, a sensory association area will guide me how to do a particular task. Or where is the illumination in the room, how I have to search it, a sensory association area is going to help me out. Okay. So I'll make it again in a simplified manner. Don't worry. Don't worry. So I got an input that is auditory. Okay. I got an input that's visual. Together they go into a zone Wernicke's through the arcuate fascicle connected. The signal goes to the Broca's and then the final speech comes out. In between, we have got two things coming in between. One is a sensory association area. Okay. Sensory association area. And another thing connected with the Broca's also is the motor association area. Where all are they located? You already know the addresses. The Wernicke's is located in the superior temporal. The Broca's is located in the inferior frontal. Between the two is the arcuate fascicle. Auditory is temporal. Visual is the occipital. Okay. So let's see each and every aphasia in a tabular manner. Okay. Now, what do you see here is an aphasia. I'll make this one as the aphasia, the type of aphasia that we see. The second column, I'll make it for the comprehension. After this, I'll show the naming thing. After that, I'll have the repetition thing. And the last thing that you see here is the fluency part. And let me add something into your notes now. Where is the lesion located inside the brain? Okay, where is the lesion, which artery is involved? I'll add on to the, you note something like, where is the lesion in the brain sitting at? Okay, so we've got four parameters: comprehension, naming, repetition, fluency, and where is the lesion to cause this particular kind of aphasia. So please be with me on this topic. It's very simple. Number one, I've got a Wernicke's aphasia. So I'll put a cross over here and write number one. Right? Good. Now remember, I'll just write in between few things. C for comprehension, N for naming, R for repetition, and F for fluency. Right? For comprehension, who came in? The auditory area came in. Who understood for me? The Wernicke's area understood for me. Who connected with the past experience of a command being followed or something to do? A sensory association area helped me for that. So look at this. Does comprehension of a particular command require a Broca's area? No. Does it require a motor association area? Obviously, no. Right. Naming. I'll go with N as a naming. Naming, you see an object, visual cortex. You understand in the Wernicke's. You relate with the same thing in the past experience. What is it? In the association area. Through the arcuate fascicle, the signal goes. And now from the Broca's area, a word has been made again from the past experiences. Look at this, please. Naming an object requires a visual input. You understood that object. You recollected from the past memory. What object is it? You connect the same thing or a signal through the arcuate fascicle. And now in the Broca's area, you derive the right name of that object. Again, an association area will require for that. Okay. But for repetition, yes. For repetition, I give the input in the auditory cortex. I understand in the Wernicke's area. Through the arcuate fascicle, I travel with the signal. And now in the Broca's area, I make the word and speak it out. Simple. So repetition doesn't require association areas. It just requires Wernicke's and Broca's with a good connection between the two. And last is a fluency part. Yes. Fluency requires the Broca's area with a motor association area again. Because how are you speaking a thing like, where are you going? For example, you speak in a decent manner. Like you tell someone moving in front of, where are you going? You'll get a slap back, you know. So again, a motor association area is helpful for me to maintaining a good fluency on my speech. Got it? So remember these parameters and it's very simple. Let's try to begin with the very first aphasia. That's the Wernicke's aphasia. Tell me now, in Wernicke's aphasia, as you understand from this. Okay, some people are coming late for the class. Good to see that. You go for a movie on time. You come for the class late. Good. Hanged. No, my system is working fine. Tell me first, in Wernicke's aphasia, what should happen to the comprehension part? Comprehension is lost here. In Wernicke's aphasia, the comprehension is lost because my patient cannot understand a particular task. Okay. Naming requires the Wernicke's area. Naming is lost. For repetition again, do you require a Wernicke's area? Yes, repetition is lost. But remember, what about the fluency? For fluency, do you require Wernicke's area or association areas? No. So fluency in these patients is actually increased. See, like Wernicke's is always inhibiting the Broca's. Like in my house, my wife is a Wernicke's area. She understands everything. And I just keep on talking in the classroom, blah, 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 blah. I am a broadcast area. So my wife always inhibits me. So when my wife is not there, I will be always uninhibited in that fashion. Okay. So remember, somewhere to some extent, we find that, you know, the fluency part in a vernacular aphasia is over increased because when they're speaking, they don't know what are they speaking. They speak a lot. Speak a lot. Yes. Speak a lot in a speech that is quite explosive to hear about, jargon speech. And very often they make certain words which carry no meaning at all, known as the neologism. Neologism. So these patients make certain words which carry no meaning. Yes. If you have seen this old movie, Three Idiots, you know, I'm very sure you must have seen that. And in that movie, Aamir Khan in the middle of the class got up in the classroom and wrote on the board two words, pre-radulization Farhan nitrate. So those two words actually carried no meaning. Everyone in the dictionary was trying to figure out what are these two terms in physics, chemistry, where are they? So actually, these are words they often make which carry no meaning, is known as neologism. Very often when you're attempting your paper and I see the theory papers and if you have to correct it, very often students suffer with this neologism. Okay. Now, remember this, in Wernicke's aphasia, where is the lesion at? The lesion is somewhere, as I mentioned earlier, the Wernicke's area. Yes, area number 22 or the superior temporal gyrus. Superior temporal gyrus. Okay. Now I'll make a very small diagram somewhere here itself so that I can show you where are these areas. Okay, so this is a lateral surface of view of the brain if I'm seeing at. So somewhere in the inferior frontal gyrus here, I get my Broca's area. Then somewhere extending on this sulcus here, I find area number 22, that is the Wernicke's area. And something connecting the two, moving around the angular gyrus, yes, this one, is the arcuate fascicle. Okay, got it? Now the point here is something from anatomy that you'll always connect in dams is that which artery supplies it. There's a middle cerebral artery, you know, supplying the motor cortex, everything. It happens to have two divisions. One goes above. One comes down. So the one which goes above supplies the Broca's area. One which goes down the inferior division supplies the Wernicke's area. So if I look at this anatomically, superior temporal gyrus or the Wernicke's area is supplied by which artery? It's supplied by the inferior division of the middle cerebral artery, MCA. The major supply of blood to the brain. Okay. Right. Okay. Now, apart from this, second aphasia is my Broca's aphasia. Right. Now, I'll put over here. So, if the lesion is in the Broca's area, as you can easily understand through this, what are the things which are lost? Naming, repetition, and fluency. Is the comprehension being lost? No. So look at this. In patients of Broca's aphasia, the comprehension is maintained intact. The naming is lost. The repetition is lost. Okay. And of course, the fluency in these patients is decreased. I'm not putting in a minus over here because it's not always absent. It might decrease. So look at this. One with three arrows up was speaking a lot, explosive in new words, neologism, jargon speech. One which is speaking less. Maybe the utterance of that word, it may be four or less. So the words are not joined to each other with a string of fluency. So you can use another thing over here. In these patients, they've got a speech which is often seen as a telegraphic speech. Now, if you remember this, you know, long back, telegram as a mode of communication in wars or anywhere used to send the signal to the Morse code. Tuck, 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 tuck. So what happened, you know, the signal also in the patient's speech comes out with a lot of interruption or a halting speech in between. That is known as a typical telegraphic speech. Remember this, in these patients often mentioned in all the books, melody of the speech is intact. Now, what is the meaning of this word melody? Like I'm speaking, I'm fluent, but I'm singing, I'm melodic. So when you're singing some song or something, do you make the words there and then only? No. The words are there in the brain in a subconscious way, and you might connect those words in a string of a melody. So remember this, these patients, when they are speaking, they are telegraphic. When they are singing, they become totally normal. Why? Because the melody of the speech is intact. In a subconscious way, whenever they have words in the brain made already, they're going to join them with a string of melody and put it as a good song. Melodic speech. Another MCQ. Okay. So just to recollect back, the great Bollywood star, King Khan, Shah Rukh Khan, whenever he gets a lot of emotions in his movies, he speaks like this, you know, but when he's singing, he becomes totally normal because melodic. Okay. And if you've seen that old movie by Ranbir Kapoor, you know, I saw that movie, the Jagga Jasoos by Anurag Basuda. And in the whole movie, Ranbir Kapoor was all the time, you know, speaking with a halting speech, telegraphic. And any time he wanted to express something to another person, he became totally normal when he started singing, melodic. Right. Remember another fact about Broca's patient. No, Dr. Ghosh, a telegraphic speech in cerebellar lesion. No, that's different. I'll come to that also. Good you asked me that. That's different. Now, remember this. Insight in these patients is normal and preserved. In Broca's, the comprehension is normal. They understand their problem. So the insight of everything going around them is totally preserved and normal. So they understand till yesterday they were talking to everyone and today they cannot communicate to anyone because they cannot speak. So ek tha tiger ban gaya barfi. Okay, that's the problem. So in these patients, you know, they go into a trap which is known as depression. Another MCQ. Depression is a very common and early finding in patients of Broca's because they cannot somewhere speak so well and they get more and more frustrated and depressed later on. Right. Now in Broca's aphasia, as you understand, where is the lesion? Tell me. The inferior frontal gyrus, area number 44, 45. And which artery supplies this part? Superior division of MCA. Superior division of MCA. Got it? Now we'll move into another aphasia. That's somewhere between the two. That's number three. Conduction aphasia. Conduction. As the word suggests, you know, we are conducting a signal from one end to the other end. And in this beautiful speech circuit, who was the conducting fiber? My arcuate fascicle, AF. And now today, I've got a lesion over here at number three. Arcuate fascicle. Simple. What are the two things which are going to get severely affected in them? Tell me. If the lesion is in the arcuate fascicle connecting the Wernicke's with the Broca's like this, it loops around like this, around the angular gyrus. What are the two things which are affected? The naming and the repetition. Is the comprehension getting affected? No. Is the fluency of the speech getting affected? No. Okay. So let me write this down. Conduction aphasia, the comprehension is normal, right? The second parameter, the naming is lost, the repetition is lost. What about the fluency? Should it increase? Should it stay normal or should it increase? Let me remind you, my wife is a Wernicke's area and I am the Broca's area. She's not around. She doesn't inhibit me. What do? I speak a lot. Correct. Right. So look at this. Fluency increases. Comprehension remains normal. Naming and repetition are the two things affected. Now the lesion is somewhere in the arcuate fascicle. Arcuate fascicle. quite a rare kind of lesions. You know, remember these, even, you know, it's not been clearly mentioned which part of MCA, but again, the books writes that arcuate fascicle again gets a supply from the middle septal artery. So the middle septal artery is again a culprit at this point, right? Chalo. Now, let me tell you, or rather ask you, from the previous students who are attending the class today, transcortical aphasias. Simple. Transcortical sensory aphasia. Okay. Transcortical motor aphasia. Right. And number six is a mixed TC that stands abbreviated for the transcortical aphasia. Okay, now pay attention. My dear friends, pay attention. It's a very simple thing. You need to be methodical while studying. There are no shortcuts. People who are attending this class for the first time must be wondering, Bob, itna mushkil kya hai? If you're systematic in your approach, it's very easy. You have to learn things in from the scratch, okay? There cannot be any bridge course to your PG selection process, okay? Transcortical sensory, transcortical motor, mixed transcortical, also known as isolation. Transcortical sensory is also known as transcortical posterior. Transcortical motor is also known as anterior, transcortical anterior. I'll come to that. Why is it posterior? Why is it anterior? There's something anatomically related to this. Chal, let's see this. Let's start with number four first. Chal, this will help me. If there is a lesion over here, okay, that's number four. Transcortical sensory aphasia. Tell me, what are the things which are going to get lost? Answer me. It's all in front of you in the diagram. If there is a transcortical motor aphasia, sensory aphasia, sorry, what are the things which are getting lost? First, comprehension getting lost. Second, naming getting lost. Is the repetition affected here? No. Remember, repetition requires auditory, Wernicke's, Broca's. It doesn't require this part. I'm telling you, you say you are a donkey. I'm telling you to repeat whatever you feel, you have to say that. Okay? Good. Will the fluency get affected? No. No. Okay. But I'll come to that. Chalo, let's write it first. In transcortical sensory number four, okay, the comprehension is lost. The naming is lost. The repetition is preserved, normal, correct. And if my wife is not there, working well with her associates, what would happen? I'll get overexcited like this. Fluency will increase. So look at this beauty, you know. Transcortical sensory or posterior transcortical is like your Wernicke's aphasia, got it? But one thing preserved in them, what? Repetition. Repetition. Okay. Where is the lesion? You know, why is it known as posterior transcortical? Because these association areas, you know, they are located somewhere posteriorly. Like there is an association area over here. That is a sensory association area, which is located somewhere posterior inferior to the Broca-Wernicke's. So I'm just drawing in the diagram so that you have a hint on this. It's posterior inferior to the Wernicke's. Okay. And remember this, I'll just draw this diagram again, that, you know, the major part of the blood supply of the brain is by which artery? This yellow wala, which is this artery. The middle cerebral artery, MCA. A fine strip on the top here, okay, will be supplied by which artery? the anterior civil artery, and some area which I see, okay, extending from behind, I'll take a light blue color here, is which artery? The posterior civil artery or the PCA. Now let me just redraw it again so that there should not be any confusion on this or any error on this. Arcuate fascicle, we're connecting the two, okay. In between, I had the MCA, supplying the major chunk, and the PCA. Now you can draw here. The sensory association area somewhere is located at the PCA-MCA junction. So which arterial infarct actually more or less produces a lesion in the sensory association area? The PCA. Okay, so you can just draw over here as well so that there should not be any confusion on this, that you can just put number 4 as this. So that you just don't connect this thing like, yeah, there's a connection loss between the two. No, actually the sensory association area is totally not working this time. Okay, so if there is a lesion in the sensory association area, most of the time we find the artery involved is the posterior civil artery. When you join our courses, you'll often read a watershed kind of a story, like there is an infarct between the PCA-MCA junction, watershed area. So you find these transcortical aphasias at this point. Okay. Okay. So let me write this down. Now we have our transcortical sensory or transcortical posterior aphasia. The lesion is in the posterior civil artery, PCA. And more or less the lesion is in the sensory association area. See, why the name transcortical came? Because the lesion was across the cortex. You know, it went here, to a larger, it tried to transfer somewhere between the arterial territories across the cortex. Okay. Now look at this. Transcortical motor. Where is the lesion? So I'll put number 5 here. Chalo, you tell me now. It's very simple. Number 5, transcortical motor. There is a lesion in the motor association area for me. Is the comprehension lost? No. Is the repetition lost? No. Is the naming lost? Yes. Is the fluency gone? Yes. Chalo. Simple ache. Comprehension normal. Repetition normal, naming gone, fluency decreased. Now where is the lesion? Why is it known as anterior transcortical? Reason now. Look at this. This motor association area is somewhere located anterior superior. You know, like this was posterior inferior. This motor association area is located anterior superior to the Broca's. In which arterial territory? ACA. Again, a watershed principle comes, and if there is an infarct at the ACA-MCA junction, this would occur more often, right? Now look at this. Here the lesion is in the anterior civil artery in the motor association area. Okay. Now comes mixed transcortical. That's number 6. Why the word mixed transcortical came? Because both of them went away. Number 6. Both of them went away. The association areas went away. The sensory as well as the motor. Yeah, good, Dr. Anjali, you put it right. The transcortical motor is the brother of Broca's with a normal repetition. Now look at number 6, mixed transcortical isolation is so alone, akela bichara. Sensory association areas, motor and sensory, both of them went away. Wernicke's is working, Broca's is working, but of what use? Can I comprehend? No. Can I name? No. Can I speak fluently? No. But one thing I can do easily, whatever I listen, I'm just going to repeat to everyone, repetition. Cheek. Balu. So repetition is normal. Comprehension lost, naming lost, fluency gone. So alone, akela. Makes transcortical isolation. So what do? You know, ask this patient, how are you? He'll say, how are you? Like I had this patient in my ward. I always tell my class, like, you know, there was a patient in ICU recovered from a stroke or something, cardiac arrest. And I went to the patient, I asked him, how are you? He answered me, how are you? I said, he's asking me for out of courtesy. I said, I'm fine. He said, I am fine. He said, that's that much only. Then I asked him, did you have your lunch? He asked me, did you have your lunch? I said, no. He said, no. Okay, good conversation. But when our HOD sir came on rounds to see that patient, sir asked me, where is the ECG of this patient? Patient looked at me and asked me, where is the ECG of this patient? Oh my God. Sensei looked at me and smiled. I said, get out. Patient also told me, get out. So look at this drama going on. Whatever the person listens, he keeps on repeating the same thing like a parrot does, you know. Not a word, parrot speech has been given to it. Whatever word I speak, he keeps on speaking the same. Echolalia. It's a very old term that is seen in these patients. Echolalia. Right. You can connect with schizophrenic patients also. Okay, that's verbigration. Actually, that's a different story there. Now, for mixed transcortical or isolation, you know, there is no arterial problems, they say. They say it commonly occurs post-cardiac arrest. It commonly occurs after carbon monoxide poisoning. There is no exact kind of a demarcation of an artery involved or an area involved in them. It's a very diffuse kind of a problem. Okay, so we'll just skip out the lesion over here. Then we have got number 7. It's known as the pure word deafness. Number 7, pure word deafness. Chalo, I'll take you back into this circuit and mark there. Number 7. There is a lesion between the auditory cortex and the Wernicke's area. This time there is a problem, maybe a neoplasm kind of a thing, which is more localized, if I'm correct on this, not an arterial involvement as such. There's a neoplasm sitting in the temporal lobe compressing the auditory circuit in such a way the auditory input doesn't go to the Wernicke's. It's very simple. What are the two things lost? Comprehension and repetition. What is normal? Naming. What is normal? Fluency. So let's write it down. Yeah, verbigration is not exactly for the words that they repeat. Maybe an activity also they keep on repeating. Okay. So I'm just telling echolalia in the words form. Lalia of the words. And my word goes and comes back. So echolalia is something for repetition of words, not the activities every time. Pure word deafness, comprehension lost, repetition lost. Naming intact, because that's the visual cortex that helps me for naming, and of course the fluency is normal. I'll give examples, don't worry. And number 8, again in pure word deafness, the lesion is somewhere between the auditory cortex and the Wernicke's area connection. Okay, so again, there is no artery as such, maybe a localized neoplasm sitting over there compressing this part. Okay, quite rare kind of a thing. Yeah, where is the lesion in mixed transcortical? It's a diffuse kind of a thing. If you look at the association areas, sensory and motor, they are quite pole apart in the brain itself. So I can just write a kind of a event like poisonings, like carbon monoxide poisoning, some patients of drowning, or any kind of a hypoxic injury in the brain, which I use as a word, diffuse hypoxia. In those patients, if there is a problem, a diffuse hypoxic injury has occurred, then they will get this problem. Okay. So pure word deafness, you know, the lesions can be an intracranial space occupying lesion, something like that. Number 8. Is pure word blindness. Pure word blindness. Look at this word. Pure word deafness, the patient was deaf to words. Pure word blindness, the patient is blind to words. Simple. It's also known by another term, that is alexia. Alexia. Cannot read, alexic. Cannot understand, maybe dyslexic. So pure word blindness. The comprehension is only decreased, I write here, conditions apply, only for one thing, reading. or you can write the word as reading only. That's up to you. Like in your salary check, you get some money, you know, 15,000, 25,000 stipend. They always write 15,000 only. I said, why to write only? They write in the prefix. Now only 15,000. I'll be very happy. Gareeb hoon main. So reputation is normal. Naming is normal. Fluency is normal. Look at this, please. So in these patients, Dr. Maleshwar, I'll come to your watershed concept also. Don't worry. I'll come to your watershed concept. Pure word blindness, alexia, is something, a comprehension problem only for reading. Rest, everything is normal. Okay. So he's just blind to words. And I'll give you running examples. For example, on this table, the vibration comes, and I know it's a mobile phone vibration because it's very synchronized. And I pick up the mobile phone. I look at the mobile from a distance, and I know it's a mobile phone for me. Okay. I'll pick it up. Because I know it's a mobile phone. It's a naming thing which I've done through the visual cortex. And I've felt the vibration. I've not heard the vibration. Now, on picking up the mobile phone, I'll start listening to it. So whatever the person is telling me something, I don't understand. Like my wife calls me every day, I don't understand her. Because I'm suffering with pure word deafness. So look at this. I cannot understand the command or word something being told. I'm deaf to words, pure word deafness. And what is pure word blindness? I'll just pick it up. I'll pick it up. And I know it's ringing. I can understand the ringtone, everything. And I'll just pick it up. Look on the screen who's calling me. So on the screen, always there is someone name in the contact list that comes to me. So I just keep on looking at the mobile phone. I don't know who's calling me. Still, I pick up the mobile phone and I can recognize that person from his voice. So this is pure word blindness. I'm blind to words. I'm deaf to words. Like in the classroom, if you are having pure word deafness and you don't pay attention to what I'm teaching you, you in the exam hall will surely suffer with pure word blindness. Whatever question will come on that topic will go over your head. Okay. Dr. Maleshwar, you got a doubt, genuine doubt, watershed area. Okay. See, there you go. See, what happens is that this association areas that I have drawn, you know, in a small diagram over here, are located at the junction of the PCA and the MCA. So if there is a watershed infarct in such a way that, you know, the PCA artery somewhere works and the MCA doesn't work. So there is a small kind of a hyperperfusion at this point. So this is a watershed thing that we understand. So you might get it, the blood from here, not get it from the other side. So there's a watershed infarct that we always see. Okay, somewhere in radiology, when you attend the classes, you'll understand it better what I'm talking about, the word watershed. Okay. Now we have got another problem. Where is the lesion for the pure word blindness? Write it down. It is the splenium part. It's the splenium part of corpus callosum. Okay, the splenium part of corpus callosum, you know, I'm not going into the anatomy again. You'll understand this into anatomy classes better, that, you know, the visual input that you receive from the occipital lobe has to travel. And to make you understand that thing which is right in front of you as a word has to arrive somewhere. So actually, for this, the lesion is somewhere located in the splenium part of the corpus callosum. The exact site is this. The exact site is this. Okay. Now, number nine, we are still not complete. Number nine is anomic aphasia. Anomic, as the name suggests, the only problem in this patient's life is to name something. So my patient has a problem in naming. Rest all is well. Right? So quite common, not a rare event. It's last but not the least, anytime anomic aphasia. It's quite common, and the lesion is somewhere located in the angular gyrus. So Dr. Indragni, you wrote that angular gyrus, the lesion is for the pure word blindness. No, just correct it once more. It's a splenium part of corpus callosum, which is the site of the lesion for the pure word blindness. For anomic aphasia, the lesion is somewhere located in the angular gyrus. Okay, it's hanging. Okay, is it coming as a black screen or intermittent hanging is there? Don't worry, that will correct, auto correct. Don't worry. sometimes some buffering happens at your end. Hang, but I can see everything fine. Is it okay? Shall I wait? I'll type here. Okay, sir. Right. One more thing to add here. MCQ, one-liners, you want a one-liner, still they are coming. Most common type of aphasia. If they ask you anytime, fugax happened. Oh my God. No hang, sir. Good. Some intermittent fugax, intermittent loss of vision, black vision will come, and don't worry. It will get corrected automatically. You'll get used to that. These are all TIAs. They are not proper strokes. Most common type of aphasia is anomic aphasia. Most common type of aphasia is anomic aphasia. Don't forget this. And anomic aphasia commonly occurs in patients of head trauma, head injury. Head trauma, head injury. Alzheimer's disease. And metabolic encephalopathy. So just write these one-liners from Harrison, very cleverly given there. Metabolic encephalopathy, Alzheimer, head trauma, these are the few major causes of the anomic aphasia that we come across. And overall, the most common aphasia is always an anomic aphasia. Last is the global aphasia. Global aphasia. In the global aphasia, what happens? Yes. Naming is gone. Oh, sorry. Comprehension gone. Naming gone. Repetition gone. Fluency gone. Everything gone is global. Simple. Now, can you tell me which artery involved? The middle cerebral artery. Superior inferior division? No. It is a proximal part of the middle cerebral artery. That means before it actually divides itself into the superior and the inferior division, somewhere over there we get a thrombus or an embolus. Global aphasia, everything gone. Okay, so that's the nutshell analysis in a tabular manner of aphasia. Almost 10 types of aphasia that I've tried to discuss. Global, anomic, pure word blindness, alexia, pure word deafness, mixed transcortical, transcortical motor, transcortical sensory, conduction, Broca's, Wernicke's, and something extra about the association areas. Now it's time to not go away, but to understand the topics better in a format of an MCQ. Okay. Sorry for the meme. In a patient, aphasic patient, question number one, just look at this, try to solve it for me. Aphasic patient deficit is most commonly seen in which of the following modalities? Tell me. Question number one. Comprehension, naming, repetition, and fluency. I think so. This is a very clever kind of a question they've asked. They've not directly asked you that which is the most common aphasia. They've asked you what is the most common deficit in an aphasic patient. Look at them. So smart are they. But we are much smarter than them naming, because anomic aphasia has got one problem only, that is naming. Okay, so anomic aphasia naming is the only most common deficit seen. Now this is something I want to discuss. A person names plental for pencil is known as what? Okay, now you know when you go out for naming something, for example, I show someone a pencil, he looks at it from a distance and he knows this is required for writing. And the person answers me it as a similar thing which is used for writing, that's the pen. Or maybe the person tells me, no, it's a plental. Plental. So while naming something, the person tells me entirely a different object having the same function. That is pen, or maybe the person pronounces the spelling of pencil in a different way as plental. This is another kind of an aphasia, but it's not put as a word aphasia. This is known as paraphasia, paraphasic disorders. Now, look at them. I've given an example that's more than sufficient to explain them. That here, the patient knows this is an object for writing, but he confuses himself between a pencil and a pen. So he knows the function of it, but he doesn't know the correct name of it. This is known as a word, semantic. Semantic paraphasia. Just write it down, semantic paraphasia. Another person knows it's an object for writing and he knows the name, but at the end, phonetically, when he's pronouncing it, he tells me entirely a different thing. That is known as a plental. That is known as what? A phonemic. Phonemic paraphasia. So you should know there are two more disorders for naming. Not only anomia or maybe a dysnomic term, it's paraphasia also, in which the person tells me another object for the same thing being used for, or maybe a different word for that object. And the answer, of course, everyone is giving me correct, is known as the phonemic paraphasia. Correct. Echolalia. Echolalia is something that is a constant repetition. I'll ask him, what is this? He'll answer me, what is this? I said, you don't know. He said, you don't know. Are you mad? Are you mad? So the thing, like, words are getting repeated again and again. Echolalia is something different. And what is circumlocution? That's beating around the bush. Yeah. Like, I still remember in my Viva OC, I went for the exam and my examiner asked me, I was roll number one, unfortunately. And my examiner asked me, what topics have you read? In community medicine, look at the tragedy. So I answered my examiner, said, there are many topics in community medicine and there are many disorders. There are many books. No, sir, there is only one book, Park. So I have read many chapters. Many things I know, sir, many things I have forgotten. So after 5 minutes of my speech, my examiner directly asked me, doctor, come after 6 months. You don't know anything at all. So this is known as beating round the bush or known as circumlocution. Write it down. Circumlocution is something in which the person beats round the bush, just to explain it, but tries to figure out the right name of the object in his speech. But still he cannot tell me, like, he doesn't tell me it's a plental or it's a pen. He tries to tell me every time, like, you know, this is an object required for writing. This is an object that I use daily. I carry it in my pocket. Everything is known as circumlocution. Okay. Right. Yeah. Damage to the categorical hemisphere usually leads to. What is the meaning of this word, categorical hemisphere? Yeah, you should know this. You know, God has given us two brains, left and right cortex. Now, first of all, let me start from the basic. Whatever hand you're using for writing is known as handedness. You know, most of the people in the world are right-handed. Some of you in the world are left-handed. I'll go with Genong for the statistical thing. 93% people in the world are right-handed and just 7% are left-handed. You know, it's a very common scenario in India. I know 100% of the people must be right-handed, because even my kids, they were using the left hand to write. I told them, no, you have to write it from the right hand. You keep on correcting this, because maybe you think that the left hand is inauspicious, something like that. But that's totally wrong, actually. If you're right-handed, right-handed, left-handed, left-handed, be it. But India, I believe maybe every one of us, most of us, maybe 97% would be right-handed. Now, what happens is this, you know, handedness gives me an idea on which area of the brain is more dominant and working more for production of speech and understanding thing. So remember this, the two hemispheres of the brain that I know are the right and the left hemispheres, correct? The right and the left hemispheres. The left hemisphere for most of us has got the speech area. So I'll take like this, the dominant hemisphere of the brain is the left hemisphere. The non-dominant hemisphere of the brain is the right hemisphere. Remember this fact first. and dominant hemisphere of the brain that contains my speech area, that is the Wernicke's and the Broca's both. Wernicke's and the Broca's both are sitting over here, is also known to me as a categorical hemisphere. Okay, the non-dominant hemisphere of the brain is also known as the representative hemisphere. There's something that you can read in between the lines of the books also, that most of the people in the world are right-handed and the left hemisphere in 90% of them is the dominant hemisphere. Okay. Dr. Ronak, I think so. We've done a lot after the global aphasia. You just continue from here. You can just see the video later on when you upload it somewhere. Okay. So representative, non-dominant, and the left is dominant, that is categorical. Representative, non-dominant doesn't have the speech area. Wernicke's and Broca's are not seen over here, while they're seen only in the left of the dominant hemisphere of the brain. So let us go back to the question. Damage to the categorical hemisphere usually leads to, this has been an old question in AIMS. It still bothers me. What is the correct answer? Damage to the categorical or the dominant hemisphere in the brain leads to increased speech, that is jargon speech, decreased speech, that is a telegraphic speech, or a senseless fluent speech, or normal speech. No, normal speech is out. So what should be the correct answer? Look at this, please. Option B and option C, if you read it again, increased speech means I'm talking more, decreased speech, that means you are talking less. Does it mean that you are aphasic? No, no, no. If that speech is overfluent and senseless in a term, I talk nonsense. I make words which carry no meaning, a jargon or maybe a neologism. So you have got multiple answers for this question. I believe many of you will answer it as C. But the look at this term, decreased speech is the only element given over here. It doesn't mean telegraphic at all. If they have read like this, you know, decreased broken speech, decreased non-fluent speech, then I would have gone with C also. But this question still bothers me because it has been repeated at least thrice. One answer, the most appropriate answer, if I can go with, I'll go with D. For the very reason option B and option C are more like a layman term. I'm talking more, you're talking less. Is it meaning aphasia? No, not at all. Okay. So I think so it remains a controversial question anytime, but I'll go with option D. Next question, let's see this easy one. A patient is being evaluated for aphasia, is unable to repeat sentences correctly and name objects properly, right? And patient's speech is effortless. And there are frequent errors in word choice and obvious difficulty in comprehension. So let me write down somewhere here. Comprehension is lost in this very patient. Correct. Naming is again something lost in this patient. Repetition is again something lost in this patient, but the patient's speech is effortless. That means his fluency is maintained or might have increased also. So which aphasia are we thinking about? Overfluent speech, jargon, neologism, Wernicke's. Now, where is the Wernicke's area located? Superior temporal gyrus. Somewhere in the posterior temporal and the parietal region. So, you know, these areas, even the Broca's, you know, somewhere lives at the frontotemporal junction. Even the Wernicke's somewhere lives at the parietotemporal junction. Okay, so I'll go with A as the best answer. But why not option D? Why not option D? Why not D? Because the answer has to be the dominant hemisphere. Remember this, aphasia occurs due to lesion in the left categorical or the dominant hemisphere. So which artery is involved in this? Let us go back to the anatomy part. Let us integrate everything. Yes, that is a superior division of MCA. Am I correct? No. It's the inferior division of MCA that supplies the Wernicke's area. Which MCA? Left MCA. So please remember, you have to develop these kind of connections in your mind, because more or less most of the exam aims need or maybe the new Mahagathbandhan exam that we have seen this time was more of integration kind of a thing. Okay. No, my dear friend, Broca's is by the superior division, Wernicke's is by the inferior division. Yes. Okay. Now look, let's try to crack this one. 75-year-old male presents with an acute stroke. On examination, he has mild right arm and the face weakness. If you're connecting this thing in your mind, the patient has got right arm and face weakness. So right arm weakness connects with a lesion in the left cortex. Okay. He has a spontaneous speech, occasional paraphasic errors, pencil, pentel, or something like that. He can understand and follow commands. Okay. Repetition is severely impaired. Which of the following best explains his speech pattern? Let me make it in a systematic manner. Patient can understand and follow command. Comprehension is not. Naming somewhere they have not given so well, but that paraphasic error explains that, you know, something has to go with the naming wrong. So I'll put a minus over here because the word paraphasic error comes in. Now there is a problem in naming also. Okay. Right. Now reputation is severely lost. Okay. Reputation is severely lost. And what about the fluency part? Oh God. Patient is talking a lot. Spontaneous speech or normal speech, I can write here. So with the lesion come somewhere. Yes. Good, good, good. Mugambo bahut khush hua. The lesion is between the Wernicke's and the Broca's, the arcuate fascicle, conduction aphasia. See, solving an MCQ is always an art. You know, clinical questions require an understanding. You just cannot play a guess game over here. So if you understand everything in a sequential manner, I believe any kind of a tough question will always seem easy for you. And take my words, doctor, that one-liners versus clinical questions are more high yield and high scoring compared to the one-liners, which can anytime go wrong at your end because they are more knowledge-based than a memory, more memory-based than a knowledge-based kind of a thing. Okay. Now let's see this one. Image-based question, just to scare you, but don't worry, it's a very simple one. Patient with aphasia has an impaired comprehension for a spoken word. Comprehension impaired for a spoken word. Impaired repetition, but has preserved naming and a fluent speech. First of all, guys, tell me which aphasia am I thinking about? Let me check up on your level. What are the things that we are having here? The comprehension is decreased for auditory input. The repetition is impaired. The naming is normal. And fluent speech is there. Can I call it as a Wernicke's aphasia first of all? Can I call it as a Wernicke's aphasia because comprehension is decreased? No. Remember, in Wernicke's what happened? Naming was also lost. Can I call it as Broca's aphasia? No. Because in Broca's the fluency is lost. Can I call it as a conduction aphasia? No, because naming is again lost over there. Yes, it's known as a pure word deafness. And in pure word deafness, where is the lesion? Between the auditory and the Wernicke's area. Maybe a space occupying lesion is somewhere sitting in the left cortex, compressing the auditory area and the Wernicke's connection. Okay. So this is how you can solve a image based kind of a thing also in the exam. It's simple. Your concepts needs to be very clear away. Number 7. Big but easy again. A 62-year-old female presents with a stroke evaluation due to acute right hemiparesis for the last several hours. On examination, she has got a right facial drop with the right arm weak and a mild sensory change in the right arm. Since the patient has got a right arm weakness, I connect that everything is connected to the left cortex of the brain. She has noted to have an effortful and a fragmented speech and is unable to name several objects. Her comprehension is intact and she has got difficulty in repetition also. Okay, if you're getting the answer correct, her comprehension is intact. Her naming is gone. Her reputation is gone. Her fluency is less. Which aphasia am I seeing it as? Broca's. Good. Which artery supplies the Broca's area? Inferior or the superior division? Superior division. Right MCA, left MCA? Always the left MCA. Got it? So that's simple, that's easy, no problem. Good. Now let's see another tricky one. Patient has got impaired comprehension only for reading, but a normal comprehension for a spoken language. Impaired comprehension only for reading, but a normal comprehension for a spoken language. Repetition of the spoken words and fluency of the speech is normal. Got it? So repetition of the word, fluency of the speech is normal. And there is only impairment of comprehension for reading. What is the problem? Can you tell me? It's the pure word blindness. It's the pure word blindness. Also known as what? Alexia. Where is the lesion like? Yes. The lesion is somewhere in the splenium part of the corpus callosum. So you guys are getting intelligent now. Good. Mogambo khush hua. Now let's look at this one also. A patient has got an impaired comprehension and naming, but has a normal repetition and a fluency. Tell me. First of all, it looks like a Wernicke's, but has a normal repetition. So who is the brother of Wernicke's with a normal repetition? A transcortical aphasia. Motor or sensory? Sensory. Sensory is posterior, anterior. Posterior. Posterior transcortical aphasia. Dr. Ghosh, don't worry. Black screen will disappear. It's fugax. Amaurosis fugax. Transient. Okay. So don't panic. Just think that you are blinking and thinking about someone else. Okay. Right. So that's easy. I don't think so. Any problem in this question 9. Now let's read this one. Oh my God, big question. 78-year-old man has a cardiac arrest while being treated in an emergency room for a chest pain. Resuscitation initiated immediately with a profound hypotension for at least 20 minutes and a cardiac rhythm is restored in the patient. Patient became unconscious for the next 3 days. He was awake, alert, extubated. His speech is limited to repetition of words and sounds pronounced by those around him. So repetition of words and sound pronounced around by the people around him is the only thing intact. While there is no apparent comprehension of language and few sounds spontaneously. Whenever the patient is spoken, he fairly repeats what was said to him. He fairly repeats what was said to him. Fairly means that he normally repeats what is said to him. So can you guess what aphasia is it? There is no problem in comprehension. Okay, comprehension is normal. Fluency is something. There is no apparent comprehension. I'm very sorry. Comprehension is decreased. Fluency is decreased. Repetition is something which is the only intact thing in him. So it is a mixture of the sensory and the motor together, the mixed transcortical. And what is this symptom known as? Echolalia. The patient repeats the word and the sounds produced around him. Okay. But last question. Sorry to bother you guys to extend the demo class also. First time I am not hearing from anyone. So when will you leave? An elderly male suffers a stroke that appears to involve the left internal capsule rather than the cerebral cortex. It results in paralysis of the right arm and the leg. Tongue deviation to the right side is lost and his speech is slurred. Slurred but fluent and grammatically correct. Which of the following describes the speech deficit in the patient? Dekho, it's very simple. I'll make a simple thing here so that you don't have any confusion ever in your life. This is the cortex for me. Cortex has got two areas, the Broca's for word formation, Wernicke's for understanding, and the connection through the arcuate fascicle. Any lesion in the cortex, we assemble together the drama as what? Aphasia. Aphasia. But don't forget, the Broca's area is connected to something below in the brainstem, that is the medulla. The medulla, the lowermost part of the brainstem, is having a nucleus for a cranial nerve whose number is 12. And from the 12th cranial nerve, the signal is going to come out to put out the word correctly to the muscles of tongue. So whatever word forms in my brain, I try to integrate everything and speak it out through the movement of the tongue. And Dr. Ghosh, something from behind helps me for connecting the words properly, that is the cerebellum also. So there is always an input for the cerebellum also coming for me. And don't forget, there is somewhere below the phonic sounds like a, b, coming from my larynx and throat. So why I'm drawing all this? Because if there is a lesion somewhere in medulla, or a connection of the Broca's with the medulla, or maybe the lesion is in the cerebellum, I put everything together as a simple term as dysarthria, difficulty in articulation of speech. Got it? While if I have a lesion below in the larynx or the pharyngeal muscle, I remember this whole drama as a word, dysphonia. Okay. Now, what are the speech deficits? Let me revise this. I want to read this simple line. I am a doctor. How will a patient of Wernicke's speak, first of all? I am a doctor. Will he speak it fluently? No. He doesn't understand, maybe. He will speak it like this. Hello, doctor. Hello, doctor. Hello, doctor. People will look at him and he'll gone mad or what? So his speech is overfluent. What about the Broca's patient? He will speak everything telegraphically. A lot of interruption, a lot of halting, and a lot of pressure applied by him. Good. While a patient with a lesion somewhere dysarthria. Now I'm going to dysarthria. If the dysarthria is the lesion somewhere medulla, okay, or the connection of the brain with medulla, what will the patient speak like? It again depends. Where is the lesion? The lesion could be in this tract. I'm writing the word CB, corticobulbar tract. So dysarthric speech can mean two types, depending on the lesion. The lesion, if at all, is in the corticobulbar tract. Look at this term, please. The connection of the Broca's area with the bulb of the brain, that is the medulla. Or maybe the lesion is somewhere below in the medulla. So what kind of speech deficit are we going to get? Dysarthria, difficulty in articulation. So corticobulbar lesion and medullary. Let me talk about medullary first. If there's a lesion in medulla, there is going to be a lot of flaccidity. We'll discuss later when you join the course that whenever there is a nuclear lesion, we get element palsy and there is a flaccid weakness. So how will I pronounce this term? I am a doctor. I'll pronounce like this. I cannot move my tongue. Look at this. I cannot move my tongue. So there's going to be a flaccid kind of a dysarthria that you find. But remember, whenever the lesion is supranuclear for a medullary lesion or any brainstem lesion, we get what? UMN symptoms, spastic. And I'll have now spastic dysarthria. I'll talk like this. I am a doctor. If you've seen patients with cerebral palsy in the ward, they often talk like this. Just go back and see on YouTube a video that we had uploaded 4 days back on amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. I've read a book sentence on flaccid dysarthria and a spastic dysarthria. Okay, you'll understand through the YouTube video on ALS. Okay, go and type on YouTube ALS, Dams Delhi page, you'll find a beautiful video that I've tried to explain this disorder. Right? And what is dysphonia? My patient cannot phonate. So he'll talk like this. So whatever the phonic words that he gets, like maybe inside the throat, he cannot just pronounce this. He might just say dr. Okay. So that's dysphonia. Now, Dr. Ghosh, what is cerebellar lesion dysarthria? If the lesion is in cerebellum, correct? You get a different speech. Yes. Which speech do you get? Scanning speech. Scanning speech. So how will this patient talk? I am a doctor. So dysarthria is defined as a speech and a language disorder when the lesion is below the cortex, in the corticobulbar tract, medulla, or maybe the cerebellum. Cerebellar lesions produce a scanning speech. Medullary lesion produces a flaccid dysarthria. Corticobulbar lesion produces a spastic dysarthria. And of course, the laryngeal or pharyngeal lesions will produce a dysphonic problems. Okay, so thank you very much. And thanks a lot to Mr. Johnny Sin to educate us the process of naming. Okay, thank you. And whenever the class finishes on time, I'm very finally very, very happy. Okay, and people who have attended the class for the first time, they can just note down my coupon code, that is ACHIMED101. I'm again row number one somewhere. Okay, so you can use this promo code to enroll for the ultimate live course. Okay, use this promo code for logging into the ultimate live course. There's a lot of things that you will learn in neurology, of course, by me. And you'll really learn in a very practical way, because what we personally feel is that somewhere at the end, it's more clinically oriented exam rather than a theoretical exam. Okay, staccato speech is something different. I think so you will read into ENT properly about that. Okay. So I'm not going into that staccato speech, this stammering kind of a speech. That's not a pure neurological kind of a thing. It can be a psychological problem also. Okay, I know medicine is tough. I know medicine is really tough. But if you understand it, I believe there should not be any problem in understanding the subject. And neuro is maths. Remember this. Neurology is like mathematics. You know, you often try to understand maths by a simple logical thinking. Same is done for neurology as well. Okay. So thank you very much for staying for the class for 1.5 hours for the first time. I'm so happy. So glad that for a demo class, people are staying for such a long time. Oh my God. Theek. So let it not be thus vidaniya or the best goodbye ever from my end. We're still going to meet a lot of times later on. Okay. So all the best.